My name is George Hart. I'm a mathematician and a sculptor. I like to take mathematical ideas and apply them to the design and fabrication of geometric art. Usually what I make is intended purely for visual enjoyment, but sometimes I make things that may also have some applications. Mathematics provides a storehouse of beautiful ideas. We explore them and keep them in the back of our mind until someday we may find a use for them. So what I want to do today is explore some ideas about structures made of parallelograms and then apply them to make a little library. So first, what is a little library? It's just a publicly accessible box of books where you, or anyone, can freely take a book or drop off a book. People make them in many shapes and sizes and place them in their front yards, or wherever, for the community to access. You'll find pictures of thousands of little libraries online. They all help spread the joy of reading. I wanted to make one for our front yard, which led me to think about possible shapes. Rectangular boxes are nicely functional, but the world of geometry provides an enormous variety of other forms that might be used. Recently, I had been exploring a type of design that might be called a zonohedral surface, so I decided to make something in that family. The key idea to understand these patterns is that if I give you two line segments in a V shape, there's a unique way for you to fill in the V to make a parallelogram. You just add two new segments of the same lengths parallel to the given segments. Depending on the lengths and angle of the two segments I give you, you might get a rhombus, a rectangle, a square, or just a generic parallelogram. But it's always flat, lying in the same plane as the two original segments. Next, things get more interesting if I give you a zigzag path to start from. Each zigzag pair is a V, so you create a series of parallelograms. This is a very simple algorithm. It's basically just vector addition, but we'll want to do it lots of times from different initial zigzags. So let's code it up and see what happens. Again, we start with a zigzag and fill in the Vs as parallelograms. But now the new edges give you new Vs, which generate a new row of faces. You can continue the process with more zigzags and more faces, going on and on and on to make a connected surface. Plus, you can go the other way, using each zag-zig pair from the initial zigzag to work backwards. Varying the lengths and angles of the initial zigzag just bends and stretches rows or columns of faces. By the way, those rows or columns are called zones, which is where the term zonohedron comes from. Equivalently, instead of starting from a zigzag, you can think of these surfaces as generated by one path of just the zigs plus another path of just the zags, analogous to how the x and y axes can generate a checkerboard. From this perspective, it's easy to see how bending one path produces an arch, or bending both paths can give a gracefully curved surface. From the engineering perspective, it's important to keep in mind that anything designed by this process is directly constructible by assembling flat parallelograms, which are easy to cut from wood or other sheet materials. Changing the lengths and angles of the generators allows you to control the resulting surface. If the initial paths wiggle through 3D space, the surface can be more interesting. There are lots of nice directions to explore using portions of these surfaces in architectural ways. But let me first add a new ingredient. From what I've said so far, you might expect all surfaces to look more or less like graph paper, perhaps skewed, but always having four quadrilaterals meeting at each vertex. To see that there are many more possibilities, let's go back to the zigzag idea, generate a portion of its surface, then pause, and add a new direction. What I've done here is insert into an existing V a degenerate zig and zag that lies right on top of itself. Because it's degenerate, it fits perfectly into the existing zigzag, but it creates two new Vs where there had been just one. When we continue filling the V process from there, now it involves a new direction. We can choose to add new directions whenever and wherever we want. To modify that example, let's insert multiple copies of the same degenerate zag-zig into all the Vs. The process continues from there with a new pattern, but it splices perfectly into the previous pattern. Note that we now see vertices of degree 3 and degree 6, so we are no longer restricted to only degree 4, like graph paper. What's happening is that if a V has an angle of 0 or 180 degrees, the parallelogram it generates has zero area, and it's invisible. It's just a line sandwiched between other faces that are visible. So in a deeper sense, the underlying pattern actually is still a checkerboard, but the invisible faces obfuscate that simplicity and result in a richer impression. Adding and removing these degenerate parts of a zigzag give lots of design possibilities when creating zonohedral surfaces. Now, let's enrich the process in a different way, by closing the zigzag, or one of the generating paths, into a loop. It isn't surprising that one can make cylinders out of rectangles. We can also make cylindrical surfaces out of parallelograms. If you now perturb the starting zigzag loop, we can produce all sorts of sinuous surfaces. So we have many interesting possibilities, but for my little library, I thought I should start with something pretty basic. We can start with a set of Vs that meet at a point and are arranged like the ribs of a half-open umbrella. Filling in the Vs leads first to an expansion, and then to a contraction to another point. This particular form is well known. It's called a polar zonohedron, roughly the shape of an American football. In terms of our V-filling process, the complete surface actually continues infinitely in both directions, with degenerate faces that cross at the nodes. As an aside, I'll mention that this is completely analogous to how mathematicians think of a cone as actually an infinite double cone. But for practical constructions, we just want a finite chunk of it. When creating a polar zonohedron, as design parameters, we can vary the number of umbrella ribs and the angle of closure to make different shapes. In the limit, as the number of ribs on the umbrella increases, the shape approaches a rotated sine wave. Now, let's combine some of these ideas and see what happens if we grow a polar zonohedron for a few steps and then do the insertion trick. We'll add some additional zigs and zags that are copies of some of the original directions. When this is grown, we get a shape that's a fusion of two polar zonohedra that fit together perfectly. By analogous steps, you can create giant complexes that fit together perfectly but are entirely constructible from planar parallelograms. Or by inserting new Vs this way, we get a different type of visual texture. And you can explore all kinds of variations. This one reminds me of a walrus. A close cousin to the polar zonohedron is this lovely helical ribbon surface. You can start it from a zigzag path that cuts across the surface. Or you can start it from an infinite zigzag that goes along one edge. And there are all sorts of elegant oscillating columns. All this is just a start to the many ways to play with these ideas. Part of their beauty is that they automatically have an internal coherence with parallel segments and a clear feeling of structure. But I know of almost no documentation about them. While much is written about convex polyhedra called zonohedra, there's almost nothing about this broader range of what I'm calling zonohedral surfaces. I can point you to a few 1970s publications by the Dutch architect Anton Hanegraaff, who made marvelous paper models. And some animated videos by Russell Towle from the 2006 to 2008 period. He discovered families of amazing space-filling forms he called spiralohedra. Each of these polyhedra can pack space without gaps or overlaps. And as an aside, I'll mention that when seen from the V-filling perspective, they're also fascinating for having membrane surfaces, like fins, back-to-back faces enclosing zero volume. And starting in 2007, Rob Bell had constructed a series of truly amazing art structures based on zonohedral surfaces at Burning Man. Look up Zonotopia for examples of his work. But no one seems to be exploring further in these directions currently, so I hope this video might get some of you more interested. An easy way for you to start exploring this family of designs is to use Zonotopia. It's a commercially available building construction set that allows you to make parallelograms in space, easily and accurately. The balls allow for 31 directions in space, and there are struts of various lengths. So you can create your own initial zigzag and start filling it in with parallelograms. Here's a basic polar zonohedron. Here's a variation with steps. Here's a spiraling column. Here's a helical surface. Here are two connected polar zonohedra. Here's a cluster of several zonohedra. Let's move on now to the little library. After considering lots of possible designs, I thought I'd start with a basic polar zonohedron and see how that goes as a learning experience before making something more complex. Putting the rotational axis vertical with tenfold symmetry seems about right. This is a nice balance between being round and feeling too polygonal. Cutting off roughly the bottom third allows it to have a stable base and an onion dome shape that has its widest diameter a bit up off the ground. It's straightforward to cut parallelograms very accurately from wood on a table saw. That's what I would use for a larger structure. But this little library will be small enough that I could cut the pieces with my laser cutter. I'm using 1/4-inch Baltic birch plywood. That's about 6 millimeters. It's not very thick, so I'm counting on the dome shape to give it structural integrity. The laser cutter leaves smoke marks, so I sand the front and back surfaces. Next, I bevel all the edges so they can butt together perfectly. There are slightly different dihedral angles between the faces at each level. They're easy to calculate, so I'm just careful to keep track of where each piece will go and label everything for reference. Because everything is cut very accurately, I decided I could just glue the panels edge to edge and use tape to hold everything while the glue dries. I started at the pole and worked layer by layer, waiting for the glue to dry before adding the next layer. So this grew in spurts over several days, relying on precise cuts and the tenfold symmetry to keep everything accurate. The bottom layer consists of half rhombi cut into isosceles triangles where it sits on the base. You can see I left an opening here for the door. And there's a shelf inside at the widest level. After a coat of primer, the inside is painted a light green, and the outside is painted yellow to match our house. The door is the trickiest part. I joined these panels with small biscuits for added strength, and I cut acrylic windows that fit in the openings in the panels. Then it all comes together finally when the door is attached and it starts to feel complete. Some routine cabinetry includes installing a handle and a magnetic latch. I made a sign to go with it, laser cutting letters in a whimsical font. Hopefully this will help people know what it is. Here it is, all finished. I haven't installed it yet, so it's just sitting here on a table until I install a post in the front yard for it to sit on. You can see a few details I didn't mention, like a rain gutter to keep out water and a small flagpole at the top, but fundamentally, it's just a nice zonohedral surface generated by a 3D zigzag. I hope people find this to be a worthy little library, and I hope this project leads more people to explore the amazing beauty and richness of mathematical patterns and surfaces.